In this video, we're going to be looking at alkene addition mechanisms. To begin with, alkenes are electron-rich, they're nucleophiles, and they react with various electrophiles. One common electrophile with which they react is a proton. One of our elementary steps in which a pi bond acts as the nucleophile, adding an electrophile to a nonpolar pi bond. This would create a carbocation intermediate. And before we go on, let's remember what makes a carbocation intermediate stable. If a carbocation has a sigma bond next door to it, that sigma bond can donate a little bit of electron density into the empty p orbital of the carbocation. This helps stabilize the carbocation, and in fact, the more sigma bonds you have next door, the more stable the carbocation is. Hydrogen, on the other hand, cannot stabilize carbocations. In the same way, pi bonds adjacent to a empty p orbital also help stabilize the carbocation by donating electron density into the pi bonds would be next door to the carbocation if the carbocation is allylic or benzylic. It has an alkene or benzene ring next door. For this reason, tertiary carbocations, which have three bonds to donate electron density through the sigma system, are more stable than secondary, which are more stable than primary, and allylic and benzylic groups, or pi bonds adjacent to the carbocation, are more stable than non-conjugated species. This actually leads to the addition of the hydrogen in a way that would make the most stable carbocation, and this trend was first observed by a Russian chemist named Markovnikov. He noticed that the H's tended to go to positions with the most H's already, or which would leave the carbocation on the more substituted center. He actually observed products, not the carbocation intermediate, as at that time the mechanism for this reaction was not known. Since we form a carbocation in this reaction, the logical next step is for a nucleophile in solution add onto that carbocation. And we know from our SN1 reaction that addition could happen on either the top face or the bottom face of the carbocation. That is, there is no stereoselectivity, and if we create a chirality center at this point, we're going to create the chirality center on either side, with no net stereoselectivity of the product. And examples you'll see in the chapter, including adding a hydrohalic acid such as HBr, HCl, or HI onto the bond where the nucleophile is the halide, adding H+ and water where the net nucleophile is water, which will eventually, after proton loss, be an alcohol, or H+ and an alcohol, which after loss of a proton, that group will become an ether at the nucleophile position. Our second major type of mechanism for addition of an electrophile to a nonpolar pi bond involves, again, the pi bond reaching out to grab the electrophile. But if the electrophile has a pair of electrons and is bigger than a proton, it can reach back around and form a new bond with the other carbon at the same time. This creates a cyclic product or a cyclic intermediate, depending on whether the E is neutral or positively charged. If it is a positively charged electrophile, then the intermediate is also positively charged, with the majority of the positive charge being on the electrophile, but a significant amount of that positive charge will reside on the more substituted of the two carbon atoms. This is simply because if you're going to elongate either of the bonds to the electrophile in this strained three-membered intermediate, the excess positive charge that results would end up localized on the center that would most well stabilize that carbocation, that is, the most substituted center. For electrophile addition forming two bonds in one step in which an intermediate is formed, a second step normally occurs with a nucleophile approaching from the opposite side in an SN2-like fashion to replace one of the bonds between the electrophile and the carbon and relieving the three-membered ring strain. This approach is at the more substituted center with the larger partial positive charge, but from the opposite side as the electrophile, which is now our leaving group, is leaving. Once the nucleophile has replaced the second carbon electrophile bond, we end up having a net addition on opposite sides, or anti-periplanar to each other. We call that anti-addition, and the second step is SN2 light coming in from the opposite side. In this reaction, we also observe Markovnikov selectivity. That is, the electrophile, not an H anymore, the electrophile tends to go to the position that is less substituted to create the delta positive where the nucleophile comes in, which is more substituted. Electrophile at the less substituted center, nucleophile at the more substituted center, or more exactly at the center that would create the more stable partial carbocation. We have another number of examples of this process in the next two chapters. For the simplest examples, either bromine or chlorine can come in and form both the electrophile with the pair of electrons and make a cyclic intermediate called a cyclic bromonium or chloronium ion. And then the halide ion left over in the first step comes in as the nucleophile in the second step to give us a net 1,2 dihalo product. Halogens can also act as the electrophile for the first step when either water or alcohol acts as the nucleophile. Mercury can act as the electrophile with either water or alcohol acting as the nucleophile. And there are a couple of reactions in which the electrophile itself is a neutral atom or group. And these two examples stop not at a plus charged intermediate, but at a neutral product in which the electrophile has formed three-membered rings. The two most common examples are to add a perbenzoic acid, such as MCPBA, metachloroperbenzoic acid, or to add a carbene, which is an intermediate formed under a couple of different sets of conditions, which involves a carbon with two bonds and a lone pair, net neutral carbon. Both of these electrophiles will make the two bonds and make a neutral product that will stop at the three-membered ring stage.